Well, happy week after Easter. Yeah, woohoo. He is risen. He's risen indeed. That was something we used to do when I was a kid. You would say, he is risen, and everybody else would say, he is risen indeed. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Yes, and he is alive. And because he is alive, we are alive. And because we are alive, we know that hope is here. We begin a brand new message series coming out of Easter with a series called Hope is Here. And the reality is this, there are tough things in life. We're gonna look at some heavy topics through this series, things like anger and addiction, anxiety, depression, grief. And there's some heavy things that we all face, and we face them in different ways at different times. And sometimes it's from an external source, sometimes it's internal. But sometimes because of that, it can feel hopeless. And oftentimes, I think we begin to long for hope, and we start to look for hope, but I think you're missing it. Hope is already here. Hope is already here, because if we're not careful, we start to think, well, if this circumstance changes, then I'll have hope. If this, what I'm facing, if this relationship dynamic can be altered somehow, then I'll have hope. If this attitude would be replaced with a different one, then I could have hope. Or if the world around me would change, then I could have hope. Hope is already here. Because Christ is here and he is risen. He's risen indeed and he lives. And because he lives, we can live. And that means our hope is already here. Our memory verse for this series is found in Romans chapter 15, verse 13. It's a little long, but it's really cool. We're gonna read it out loud. Online, we want you to read this out loud. Actually, do it out loud, okay? I know you can and you will. So let's all do this out loud together. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Yes, this verse is so good. We want to overflow with hope by the power of who? The Holy Spirit. That's the key there. Hope is here because the Holy Spirit dwells inside of us. If we would tap into that and accept that God's presence is in us, then we already have a hope, an indwelling hope, that now we're able to overflow with hope. You want to be an attractive church? You want to have a message that is meaningful and appealing and pulls at the heartstrings of people? Then be a people, a church of hope, that is embracing hope and overflowing with hope. Not just a hope that we cling to on our own and kind of keep in private, but a hope that is overflowing. It is just pouring out of us because we can't contain it and we can't keep it in. And it's not the kind of hope that we just go, okay, all right, you're right. I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna have hope in this situation. I'm gonna work harder at being hopeful. And it's by the power of the Holy Spirit. Hope is here. This hope is already present. It's a matter of recognizing, accepting, saying yes to God, and allowing this hope to move out of us. And so we kick off the series with a message on anger. Yay! It's so much fun to talk about, but it is so important because I don't know if you've noticed, but there's a lot of angry people out there. I can certainly be one of them. I know that's hard to imagine, but I do lose my cool, and part of the reason, you know, I lose my cool so much is because I picked about the worst hobby you could have if you don't want to be angry. I like to play golf. And this sport is maddening because, you know, when you play golf, you have this expectation of perfection. Right, I'm going to hit a perfect golf shot every time because that one time I almost hit a perfect golf shot, so why wouldn't I just do it every time? I mean, you have the ball is stationary. It's not moving. Why can't I just hit this thing perfectly every time? And anytime you don't, there is this temptation to lose your cool and be angry. Plus, you have all these external things that are going on. It's such a mental game. And, you know, other people, maybe your competitors are playing against, they may be messing with you. I have friends, they're not my friends anymore, but they used to be my friends. And they like to get in my head, which is so easy because I'm a basket case. I'm like the easiest person in the world to mess with on the golf course. And then there's like other things, like there's the weather, there's the stuff that's going on the course, there's the bounces that the ball may have, good and bad, you can't control that. And it's that feeling of being out of control, I think for many of us, that incites anger. When we feel out of control and we can't control what's happening around us, sometimes our response is to respond in anger. That may be driven out of fear, you know, of that being out of control, but it happens. There was one time a couple of years ago where I was playing on a course that is just notorious for having a lot of maintenance people on the course, and they don't care that you're playing golf there. They're like doing their job and they're driving all over the place. And this one day I got so frustrated and mad at the golf course and the maintenance crew, and this had been going on all summer, and it was about the fifth shot in a row where a maintenance vehicle had driven past me while I was hitting. And I was so mad. I looked up and they had a ball washer, one of those things where you put your ball in it and you do like this and it cleans your ball. It was right in front of me and I'd hit a bad shot. And I was like, that's it. I'm going to destroy something on this course. I'm going to destroy this ball washer. And so I've seen these my whole life. You know, they're green plastic ball washers. And so I dropped my club and I took my fist and I punched it as hard as I could with the intent. I wanted it to just explode with ball washing stuff up in the air. And I was like, the course owes this to me. But when I punched it, I discovered it was not made of plastic. It is made of concrete. And I still feel it in my pinky knuckle like every single day. And it's this reminder that I'm a moron. It's the reminder. And it's not a good thing. And here's what I can tell you. It is impossible to play golf well when you're angry. You can't, I haven't seen anybody do it yet. You get angry, you know, other things in life you can do. Like, you know, other sports, you can get mad, bear down, I'm gonna play harder, I'm gonna be more aggressive, I'm gonna really take out my aggression and play harder. Like, you can play football angry and play really well. But you cannot play golf angry and play well, or at least I haven't seen anybody who can. I've also discovered it's impossible to follow Jesus when you're angry. You just can't do it. And there are a lot of quote-unquote angry Christians out there. Like, they're really, really just mad. They're mad at the world, they're mad at their churches, they're mad at their pastors, they're mad at their spouses, they're mad at their neighbors, they're angry, they're mad at their boss, their employer, they're mad at their coworkers, they're just angry, mad at culture and what's happening all the time. And they're so angry, and I will just tell you, you can't follow Jesus when you're angry because you won't go where he's going. You won't think like he's thinking, you won't talk like he talks. And so that anger is such a consuming thing. It becomes our God. It takes over. Now, there are a lot of things you can do in life while you're angry. You could probably make a lot of money angry. Probably could. There's probably certain things that you could succeed at in this world while you're angry, but you will not be able to produce the kind of fruit that Jesus desires, that fruit of the Holy Spirit where hope is here, overflowing, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There was no anger in there. In fact, all those things are like the opposite of anger. So when we recognize that hope is here, then we understand that we can overflow with hope. When we allow the Holy Spirit to do his thing inside of us, then we're free to follow Jesus. So let's dig in and let's think a little bit about anger. First of all, anger requires a response, not a reaction. This is an important thing to think of because anger happens. There are gonna be things that occur that incite anger. And in and of itself, just that feeling of anger, that moment when anger hits, that's not necessarily sinful, right? Anger is a reaction we can initially have, but then we wanna take that captive and say, all right, I want a measured response, not a reaction in this situation. Because when we react in that, typically that's where sin comes rushing in. We say horrible things, we do horrible things, and part of it is because our hope at that point is misplaced. Just think about it. When you're angry and you're kind of engaged in that particular emotion, what is it you're hoping for? Just think about that. When you're angry, what is it you're hoping for? Typically, we're hoping that bad things will happen to the people we're angry at. We're hoping for revenge. We can even start to daydream about how we could best get our revenge and what that would look like. We are hoping for punishment. I hope they get, you know, what they deserve and that they're punished so they learn their lesson and they don't do that again. Or we hope that we can get the upper hand in that relationship because, again, we feel out of control and we're hoping to get there. Maybe we hope to hurt people. Well, all these things are misplaced hope and false hope, and not the hope that the Holy Spirit gives us. In fact, they run completely contrary to him. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26, it says, in your anger, do not what? Sin. In your anger, do not sin. So just being angry or experiencing that anger isn't necessarily sin, but when you're angry and you experience this, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. So there's three things there in that one passage that kind of show us how to respond. So when you think about how to respond, go to the next one, please. When you think about how to respond, we have do not sin. Second, do not hold on to it. And finally, do not give the devil a foothold. So that anger that happens through whatever the dynamic is, and maybe it's an ongoing thing, maybe it's just something that triggers you, but it's always kind of lurking beneath the surface there. When that happens, first of all, do not sin. Say, all right, I'm not gonna react because my reaction's probably not going to be godly. It's probably not gonna be honoring him. It's probably not gonna be driven by the Holy Spirit with the hope that he provides overflowing out of me. It's probably gonna be sinful. So stop right there. Call a timeout. Say, all right, I'm not going to react. Instead, I'm going to respond. And my response, I'm not gonna sin. That's number one. Number one goal when we feel anger is I'm not gonna sin. So let's not do that. The second one, don't hold on to it. The scripture there says, don't let the sun go down on your anger. Don't try to maintain that anger, which I know sounds silly. Like, why would you want to maintain a negative emotion? But let's face it, do we not do that? We feed it. We replay the scenarios over and over again in our heads. We start to assume the worst about other people. We start attributing things to them that they're thinking and saying and believing that we have no idea of knowing that they would be. And we're feeding and fueling an anger that is quenching the Holy Spirit, like suppressing him inside of us, where we're pressing him down. Instead of overflowing with hope, we're suppressing and pressing down the Holy Spirit. We're quenching that fire. You know, we're dousing that flame with water because we're choosing to hold on to that anger. And it's easy. You could think, well, I need this anger. It's my protection. It's my defense mechanism. But you foster that overnight, you wake up angry the next day. And the thing is, we think we can direct our anger. Well, I'm just angry at this person, or I'm just angry about this situation, or I'm just angry at this particular thing that's going on in the world. But it doesn't work that way. Anger is a dominant emotion. When we have this anger and we maintain it, as opposed to taking it to God, releasing it to him, trusting it in him, and letting that go, we hold on to it. Now, all of a sudden, that anger starts impacting every single relationship we have. Now, I know you think you're unique and you're special and you're different. And I just want to tell you on this one, you're wrong. You really are probably wrong. Nobody can do it. It spreads to everyone. And then we become these angry people and we're suppressing the Holy Spirit. And then don't give the devil a foothold. To give the devil a foothold means that he's got leverage in your life. He's got leverage in your life. Like, his primary goal is not necessarily to get you to worship him. It's just to keep you from being effective in leading others to Jesus. And anger, I mean, just think about it. You can't follow Jesus when you're angry. So if he could just get you angry, just get you mad at, those people, whoever those people are, he just gets you mad, he's got a foothold. He's got leverage on you so that now you're not going to follow Jesus. You're not going to go where he would go, think what he would think, say what he would say, or do what he would do. He's got leverage, he's got a foothold in your life. We don't want to give Satan a foothold in our lives, or a stronghold where he's got a hold of us and he is holding us back from following Jesus and allowing the Holy Spirit and the hope that he provides to overflow from within us. So respond, don't react. Also, when anger happens, I would encourage you to identify the source of your anger before you respond. All right, this happens. Anger has occurred. What is happening here? You're driving down the road, somebody almost cut you off. Rah! Okay, before you make hand gestures or loud noises or anything else, time out. What is causing this? What is the root cause of this anger? And that one, it may be fear. Fear that you're going to die, because it was a near crash and safety is of utmost importance. So instead of acting like a maniac and making it unsafe for everybody else on the road, including yourself, you want to have a response there that is appropriate. Maybe it's because you feel that somebody cutting you off in traffic is they're disrespecting you. Well, this other person doesn't know you and not likely that they're going, I'm going to show them a lesson. I put her in her place, or probably not what's going on there. They probably just made a mistake, or You know, so instead of responding, you know, so now you can look at that and go, okay, well, where does that feeling of disrespect come from? Well, it probably came from your dad, but anyway, I don't know that for sure, but where is that coming from? So you want to identify the source of that. And I think that there are, you know, essentially three places where anger really derives from. There's these three kinds. And so Jesus experienced some anger. In fact, in the scriptures, there's one particular story where it talks about Jesus being angry. It's not the one where he overturns the tables in the temple. That's not what you think. It was a very measured response. It was a planned thing. He didn't go in and flip out. He knew what was going on and had a plan, and he responded in that. But there's a story in Mark chapter 3, verse 1, and Jesus is going to feel anger, and it definitely says that he's experienced anger here, but he identifies, I think, the source of that so that his response honors the Father instead of being an inappropriate response. Mark chapter 3, verse 1, it says, another time, Jesus went into the synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there. Some of them were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal him on the Sabbath. Jesus said to the man with the shriveled hand, stand up in front of everyone. Then Jesus asked them, which is lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or to do evil, to save life or to kill? But they remained silent. He looked around at them in anger and deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts, said to the man, stretch out your hand. He stretched it out and his hand was completely restored. Then the Pharisees went out and began to plot with the Herodians how they might kill Jesus. So by identifying the source of what's happening here, it says that Jesus was angry at their hardened hearts. That's what he was angry about. And he was deeply distressed at their stubborn, hardened hearts. Here they are, you know, using a man with a shriveled hand to try to find a reason to accuse him by healing this guy on the Sabbath. So what's he going to do? What's his response going to be? By identifying the source and what's happening here, he can have an appropriate response in this anger. So there's three kinds of anger, and I think Jesus may have experienced all of them here. The first is a defensive kind of anger. This is where you feel threatened or attacked. So the Pharisees here were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus. They were wanting to arrest him. They were plotting already to kill him. So there could have been that initial, like, you know, defense mechanism, kind of instinct kick in of what is this? You know, they're threatening me. There is the offensive. This is where somebody else is being attacked or something is going on and you want to step in and do something. Like you see somebody being bullied or taken advantage of and you're like, this isn't right. And so here's this guy, they're using him as a pawn to try to accuse him. He's got a shriveled hand and so Jesus is like, stand up in front of everybody. And so that could have been present as well. And then there is the righteous. And this, by the way, is the most rare. But it can happen, and it does, where there is this kind of like, wait a minute, there is something right to be done here. There is something right. And to do that right thing with the right heart honors God. And that's how we overflow with hope. Hope is here in this story where they're trying to accuse Jesus and they're belittling this man with the shriveled hand and, you know, taking advantage of him and using him as bait and a trap for Jesus. There is a righteous moment here for a righteous response. And so what does Jesus do? How does he respond? He heals the man. That's how he responds. He does the most righteous thing he could do, even though it's on the Sabbath and those religious leaders are gonna lose their minds over this and see, he can't be from God. And yet this man's hand is restored. And he heals him because that is a righteous response. By identifying where the anger is coming from, I think it helps us to allow the Holy Spirit to lead us in our response. We identify the source. If I'm just being defensive, okay, well, all right, can I die to self? Can I back off here? Am I okay? Am I content and comfortable with who I am in Jesus, that I don't have to stand up and defend myself and, you know, show everybody that I'm something special? Maybe, I don't know, maybe you can just let that go. That'd be pretty cool. Pretty powerful there to go, yeah, I'm okay. I don't have to prove anything to anybody, I'm all set. Or if it's the defensive, like somebody else is being threatened, I mean, are you able to just, step in and say, okay, instead of just being angry at everyone, right, I'm with you, I'm for you, you're not alone, I've got you, you know, you're not gonna face this by yourself, and to actually do something, because a lot of times we don't do anything other than just get mad. We're, you know, or go on social media and post about it. But, which really isn't doing anything, guys. I hope you understand that. It's not. So, you know, all that energy, you know, commenting and arguing, and just why don't you go find somebody and love on them and be with them and show them the love of Jesus. And then you're able to have, okay, a righteous response. And if something needs to happen, now you know you're not standing alone. You're standing with the power of the Holy Spirit, who you have not suppressed in anger, but who is overflowing. This hope is here, so you can trust him in that response. Now, this is really good. It's my favorite part of the whole message right here. Check this out. Plan to over-respond instead of overreact. Isn't that cool? Plan, just make a plan right now. You gotta change the way you think. Plan to over-respond instead of overreact, because that's the problem with anger, right? In our anger, when we sin, it's oftentimes because we overreact. Here's this situation, now we escalate the situation. Now the other people are like, I'm mad. Now I'm gonna escalate the situation. Oh my goodness, well, I gotta escalate it some more. So instead of overreacting, if we have a plan to over-respond, what a powerful thing that we have the opportunity to do there. And Jesus speaks to this, Matthew chapter 5, Sermon on the Mount. This passage may sound really familiar to you. You've probably heard this one before. Verse 38, he says, "You have heard that it was said, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile with them, go 2. Jesus is saying, hey, you need to be prepared for these moments. People are gonna do these things. So have a plan to over-respond instead of overreact. Somebody comes up and you know they slap you. You know, maybe you're ready to have a fist fight. Well, now and you can see how quickly things would escalate there, because that's your reaction. And you may think that reaction is justified, or it's perfectly normal, it's okay. But Jesus is saying, hey, man, think about this differently. Look at this in a different way. Plan to over-respond. Somebody slaps you, you don't have to get in a fist fight. You can say, oh, you can slap me on the other cheek. Well, I mean, they may be like, all right. But I'm gonna tell you right now, like, even if they do slap you on the other cheek, some of the joy is gone out of it, because they didn't get the reaction they wanted. They were looking for a fight. They're looking for things to escalate, and they don't get the reaction they want. It fizzles kind of fast. There's no fuel for the fire. And so you plan to over-respond, and the next thing you know, those fires of anger are actually getting suppressed and put out in others, and there's a greater likelihood that now the Holy Spirit can rise up, and this hope that is here can be free to come out. And so what does it look like to over-respond? First of all, repent. Repent means to change the way you think. So Jesus starts off this saying, like he does a lot of sayings in the Sermon on the Mount, and he says, you have heard it said, eye for an eye. Right? Eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. But don't resist an evil person. That's what he says. So he says, hey, think about this differently. That's what it means to repent. Change your worldview. Look at life and people and situations differently. The way that God would look at them, the way the Holy Spirit inside of you is like, you know, whispering with this still small voice, you know, saying, hey, this doesn't have to be that way. So repent, change the way you think. Second, remember. Remember that you yourself are an object of God's grace. Remember his mercy. Remember his compassion. Remember that he is slow to anger, rich in love. He is gracious and compassionate, that he has been good to you, that he has chosen you. Remember what your identity is. Remember who it is that dwells inside of you. Remember, so that you can plan to over-respond instead of overreact. And then release. Release the hope that is in you. This hope of the Holy Spirit, instead of suppressing him, release the hope that is here in that situation, because this is the best hope that is available. So when he says, okay, don't resist an evil person, if somebody slaps you, give him the other cheek. If somebody wants to sue you for your shirt, give him your coat as well. Or if somebody forces you to go 1 mile, go the extra mile. Go above and beyond. It's a release of this hope that is inside of us that is already here. And it changes your world. It will, I guarantee you, if you over-respond instead of overreact in your anger, it will change your home. I promise you that. And I know you're already going, yeah, but you don't know about him. I don't need to know about him. I know about you. I don't need to know about her. I know about you. I don't need to know about them. I know about you. You plan to over-respond instead of overreact. It will change your home. It will change your neighborhood. It will change your workplace and your school. It will change your friendships. It will change your family dynamic. Because this hope now that is coming out of you is something that's attractive and contagious and people want to know about. And then if you're thinking about, you know, the best response that you could possibly have to anger, the best response is this: forgiveness. Forgiveness is the best response to anger. If we would just be quick to forgive, not holding on to grudges, but rather letting them go and doing it again and again and again and again. In Matthew 18, Jesus is asked by Peter about forgiveness. Verse 21, it says, "Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, 'Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to 7 times? And Jesus answered, "I tell you, not 7 times, but 77 times. This is a really kind of cool interaction that Jesus is having here with Peter. At this point, you know, Jesus and Peter have been together for a few years, like close to 3. And Peter's going, okay, this guy's different. He's got a different approach to things. Typical standard approach to the same way we have today is, you know, 3 strikes and you're out, you know. Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, you know, shame. Whatever, George Bush couldn't get it right, why could I? Yeah. And, you know, but we kind of have that mentality that says, okay, you know, you're out of here. And so so he was like, hey, you know what, this Jesus guy's pretty generous. This Jesus guy's kind of over the top. This Jesus guy that we're following, right? You know, he's so different. He keeps talking to the Pharisees, even though they're trying to kill him. And I mean, Jesus had Judas in his midst who would betray him, and he knew that. And yet he washes his feet. And I mean, Peter is like, so Jesus, like, not 3, but 7? Like, that sounds pretty good. And Jesus is like, no. I mean, Peter, by the way, is for rocks. Peter means rock, which really I think Jesus kind of gave him that nickname because he's dumb as a rock sometimes. he's like real aggressive, you know, gung-ho, and you know, God uses him in powerful ways. But Peter's like, 7? And he's like, yo, rockhead. Yeah, not 7. 77. Now, Peter, you know, could have been like the rest of us and going, okay, well, I mean, I better get my abacus out and, you know, a little slate tablet and start keeping track. And when I get to 77, you know, 78, you're out. But really what Jesus here was saying is this is ultimate forgiveness. You're free to actually forgive in a limitless way when you have the hope of the Holy Spirit in you, because you know you've been forgiven in this way. So these numbers are kind of significant. In Genesis chapter 4, there is this character named Lamech. He's 5 generations removed from Cain. Cain is his great, 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 great grandfather, I think. And Cain murdered his brother Abel. So Adam and Eve had Cain and Abel. Cain murders his brother Abel. And so the consequence of this, God's like, hey, Cain, you really can't be trusted. You know, we need to remove you from this dynamic. And so he said, Cain, you're going to wander the earth. And Cain was really freaked out by that. And he's like, yeah, but if I become a wanderer of the earth, other people will kill me. And God told Cain, he said, no, I'm going to put a mark on you. And if anybody kills you, I will take vengeance for you 7 times over. I'll take vengeance 7 times. So that was like the mark on Cain and the story with Cain. 5 generations later, you get Lamech. Well, Lamech is, his little story there in Genesis 4 is he is wounded, a slight injury by a young man on accident. And so Lamech kills him. And then he calls his 2 wives to him and he says, wives of Lamech, which is great. He refers to himself in the third person. First place I know of that happening. You know, so this Lamech guy, he's that dude. Wives of Lamech, you know. I killed a young man today for wounding me. I murdered him. You know, if Cain is avenged 7 times, then Lamech is avenged 77 times. Oh, Jesus knew this passage, obviously, from Genesis 4. He knew this story. Peter knew this story. They all knew this story because God's vengeance, you know, was 7 times for Cain. But Cain was like, well, if God takes vengeance 7 times over, then Lamech's going to take it 77. And here's what I can tell you about humans and vengeance, myself, you, all of us. When it comes to vengeance, humans always go too far. When it comes to vengeance, humans always go too far. And when it comes to forgiveness, we never go far enough. But hope is here. And it doesn't diminish what's happened to you. It just releases you from that terrible trap of anger that has had a stronghold on you for maybe a long, long time. And so when Jesus said, no, Peter, 77 times, again and again and again and again, limitless, he was saying, take this all the way, just like your God has taken it all the way for you. This is the power of his Holy Spirit that is inside of you, setting you free to forgive like this. Hope is here. May it overflow out of you. So as we share in a time of communion together, we celebrate the hope that is here. And if you have some anger in your heart, maybe today would be just a really great day to just ask God to put a name on it. Let's name that anger. Let's call it what it is. And then to give you the opportunity as you are forgiven, that's what we do in communion. We're saying yes to his forgiveness for what Jesus has done. It doesn't hold that against us, but he also wants to release us from it and set us free. And so don't waste this moment with him right now. Online, don't waste this moment with him right now. Make the most of it. As we celebrate his forgiveness, and no matter who you are or what you've done or what's been done to you, this invitation is for you. Take the bread and take the juice. They remind us of God's forgiveness that goes exactly far enough. Receive that. Say yes to it. Hold on to the bread and juice, and so we've all been served, and then we'll eat and drink together. But while you hold that, say, God, just as you've forgiven me, and just as you've placed your Holy Spirit inside of me, God, I trust that you give me power to forgive so that I can over-respond instead of overreact. I'm going to pray for you, and then let's spend some time with him, letting him do his work. Father, we thank you. Thank you that your forgiveness is exactly what we need, and it's here. We thank you for your promise, Holy Spirit. Lord, that anger that maybe is right beneath the surface or has even come out today or maybe lurking a little bit deeper, maybe something that's even been unnamed that we've been carrying, Lord, shine a light on it. Search us and know our hearts. Show us. Put a name to it so we could think about this differently and we could offer it to you and trust you with it. And so we could do what you would do. We could forgive like you forgive. I pray that in this holy moment, God, you would do holy work through the power of your Holy Spirit. And we would overflow with hope because we have been set free. Because he is risen. He is risen indeed.